This morning's mini masterclass is on vacuum excavation. And we've got four speakers for you today. Charles Ashdown is going to start giving us a sort of overview of what the problem is and some of the solutions. And we've got three speakers who are going to talk about vacuum excavation systems from their particular companies, one of which is an international perspective. So we're going to start with Charles Ashdown's presentation. Charles is a consultant. He's been actively working with Exova, and he's also been very active over the years with development of international standards with particular reference to trenchless technology. So without further ado, can I ask Charles to come up and give his presentation? Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I first of all would like you to read the written slides that I put up. I don't read them out, so please read them before anyone says, another engineer can't read. I can read, but you can read them faster than I can. My generation had the three R's, you remember, reading, writing, arithmetic. So reading is no problem. I had a problem with spelling because of the writing and the arithmetic. But apart from that, things went jolly well. You have to excuse my ham-fistedness with some of the modern technology. I want to start with a bit of history, because that's where I was first interested in digging holes. A very small team, basically just two engineers, but it was very, very successful. So there are some lessons that possibly could be applied today, so I'll run quickly through them. We weren't allowed to do anything if it reduced the level of service. We were very lucky we had a very understanding chief executive. He looked at our proposals, he said, that's good, you'll need a budget. How much do you want? And he gave it to us. Before you say I don't believe you, he was educated at Harvard. And as you know, they say, you can always tell a Harvard man, but you can't tell him much. And he knew what we needed. He gave us the money. We had engineers run the project, not managers, so we actually knew what was happening and how to make it happen, or why it wasn't. And that was a key. We had running already a very good finance system. And we wrote a program to interface with that, to pull data out, so we could work on it and we could see the effects of what we were doing. We didn't sit in our offices and think of ideas, we went out into the patch and talked to the men who actually did the work. Supported them, and we had a magazine which produced a lot of competition, and it worked very well. We identified a high-cost element as getting at the buried infrastructure. First, the first main layers we talked to, the foreman there put his finger right on the real problem. He said, the problem with our buried pipes, see, is that we've buried them. And that's still the problem today. So, with our technique of going out into the field and talking to the men, we went out and worked for a couple of weeks with gangs of main layers, and we asked them what they thought and what they could do. And they were very constructive. These holes had to be a reasonable size so that the men could get in to dig them in the first place, but they were fairly large. And they suggested down the hole tool for electrofusion service fittings, because we were doing a lot of pipe bursting and there were a lot of holes involved. So a couple of months working with Fusion Provider, as they were called then, produced this tool which enabled us to put electrofusion service connections on down the hole. It's very simple. There is... Well, Can you see that? Yes. There's a fitting here that holds the electrofusion fitting. There's a spring here which top loads it when you put it down the hole. You close these jaws up with these two Bowden cables, which are handles at the top. So there it is with the fitting in it. Provided you've remembered to plug the fitting into the box before you lower it down the hole, it's relatively straightforward. It worked extremely well. We tried them, but not much hope. Vacuum excavators in those days were generally big and cumbersome. A lot of holes involved, it was still cheaper, but not for individual holes. And we were looking at ways of getting around this, say milling machines. One actually, main layer, had a stupid suggestion, which seemed stupid at the time. He said, why don't we get a big hole saw and cut a slab out and lift it out of the road? But anyway, we got on, and the main layers were very enthusiastic. They wanted to do strap ferrules, and they wanted me to develop the strap ferrule fitting and tool. But we couldn't work fast enough. They developed their own technique, which basically involves selecting the lightest member of the gang and holding him upside down. Thus, it did actually work, and they were installing strap ferrules underwater with this technique very successfully. Health and safety didn't really come into it in those days. Passers-by asked what he was doing, and we used to joke and say, well, he's a Scot, he's dropped sixpence down there. And the other thing, you'll see the quality assurance there. In Wales, we have a lot of sheep, and we always have a sheep there to make sure nobody's getting fleeced. We also had a very hard line authority in Welsh Water. The authority membership were very strict with us, gave us a hard time. We had a sort of tongue-in-cheek motto when we came out of these meetings with them: from the jaws of success we will snatch defeat. And sadly, the government picked up on this and applied it to the water industry. At a stroke, we lost our most valuable resource: generations of experience and expertise and knowledge. And it's taken a long time to get anywhere from there. However, moving on quickly, before I get onto that too much, 30 years down the road, at least the problem we were working on has been solved. This is one of the latest sort of vehicles. It's a one-man operation. You can see the coring machine on the back and the vacuum tank on the back, all in the one vehicle. And for anyone who hasn't actually seen it in operation, a very quick run-through. This is British Gas going back 5 or 6 years, I think, working outside a mosque in Birmingham just before the riots broke loose. It had nothing to do with me, but this man is just about to drop the coring machine into the road. It produces a plug. That was a very hard road there. In about 10 minutes' time, you could lift that out. We put marks on it so it could be put back in the right place. After that, the vacuum excavator continues until you're down to expose the main. This is a slightly different hole, actually, but it's the same thing. They've now tipped the material back out of the vacuum excavator to go back in the hole. And it's surprising, particularly if you've got a big, heavy road surface and the plug is quite big, it's surprising how little material is actually required. Also, because the hole is very small, the material can't escape from your compactor. So you can, in fact, now compact with a relatively small pneumatic tamper, and you've got no subsidence problems. You then mix up a big tub of goo, some sort of resin, and you pour it in the hole, and then you put the plug back in. Now you can see the contractors are making a lot of money here because he's got a gold Rolex on site. He wriggles this around until the goo comes up through the cracks, and after a couple of minutes you can scrape that off clean, and 30 minutes later you can run traffic over that. So now, instead of a typical pipe burst where you've got a whole line of big square holes down the road, these are actually relatively small holes compared to a lot of places, instead you've got this, and you can see the four holes that we've dug, looking for leaking flanges in the gas main. But that we did four, or was it five? Four, certainly four holes we did between the hours of 10 o'clock in the morning and 3 o'clock in the afternoon. We cored them, repaired the flanges, or repaired two of the flanges, they were the two we found, and had the traffic back before we left. Well, after we left, actually. However, there is a problem with vacuum excavators that has not been solved. I've been trying to persuade manufacturers to solve it. And the number of demonstrations I've seen where once we get into the clay spade comes out. I think the utilities have to take the lead here. Commercially, I can see the point. Why bother to do work if we are selling our product as much as we want? But I certainly know it can be done. I saw this in Australia working extremely well. No Dig Australia, which must be 15 years ago at least. But anyway, it works. It can be done. You need to have the right design nozzles. It's quite technical, but it can be done. And I would like to suggest to the water industry that we start the ball rolling thus. I cannot understand how we can allow clay spades to be used in this way. Although the water industry uses contractors now, this doesn't remove the responsibility from them for ensuring a safe workplace. And putting a clay spade into the ground does not constitute a safe workplace, in my view. I would certainly never have allowed it for my workforce, and I'm really surprised and disappointed that we do at the moment. This shows you what the technique was. This is a conceptual drawing, but there are four sets of nozzles, air and water. Two sets fire straight down, and when you rotate the head, it cuts the periphery of a circular plug. And while you're doing this, the cross jets are actually slicing the plug up into little pieces, and they're whistling off up the pipe. You only want water when you need to cut clay. So when the pipe stops going down, when it's got through the soft stuff and starts getting into cohesive material and the pipe stops going down of its own accord, you wriggle the pipe and press the trigger for the water. Very small amounts of water are required, and I was surprised to see that the material that they were excavating in Australia with this technique appeared to be almost dry. So it can be done. This is a nozzle that, a suction head that has been used. You can see the technique. You can see the two nozzles that are pointing down and the two that are pointing across, but they're placed inside the pipe, which is not a good idea. They get damaged very easily by things rushing up past them, knocking them, and they also cause a bottleneck. This was continually blocking up, so it didn't have much favour. But trials do need to continue, and in a lot of places, they are doing so. And these figures are from contractors, but I've used very conservative financial figures so that you can't complain I'm exaggerating the savings. There's also the saving in transport, bringing the material onto site and off site, and the pollution, the traffic pollution and all the rest of it. And your vehicles coming in and out add to the traffic congestion anyway. I cannot understand why the water industry has been so reluctant to grasp the potential for this. The amount of money that could be saved is absolutely staggering. As always, there's a catch. We've been struggling for years, ever since we saw the introduction of, or the appearance of rather, CoreInVac. We've been struggling to get the water industry interested in it. And we've been talking to manufacturers, contractors, and the water industry itself to find out what the problems are. There are four main factors we found. That should be fairly obvious, but it's a commercial necessity. If you can't see the product selling, you're not going to invest in developing it. And there's a lot of work goes into it. The result of this is your catch-22. You can't develop a proper working proven fitting or technique or whatever unless you have field trials. And if the water companies won't provide or are reluctant to provide the sites for field trials, and I can understand why, because of, you've only got to try and work in London with the road closures and the traffic and all the rest of it, to do a series of trials that probably don't work at first is not really going to find favour. But nevertheless, that's why nothing gets done. So, these opinions, they're not hearsay, they're all things people have told me. I've put historical in there because the last year, some of these opinions, particularly the more damaging ones, are starting to change. There is hope. There's light at the end of the tunnel. I'll run fairly quickly through these. Now those four probably spell out both the hub of the problem, or the nub of the problem. Anyway, they spell out the problem, and they also should shed some light on the solution. When I started my career, if I'd used any of those sort of excuses to my bosses, my career would have been very, very short. In those days, you didn't have to issue about six verbal warnings and a dozen written warnings and then disciplinary hearings. They just kicked you out. And a lot of store was set by specifications and contracts. It was drilled into us that they must be comprehensive, they must be clear and unambiguous, and they must be flexible. Now, particularly with civil contracts, nothing actually works as it's supposed to, because not because of civil engineers. I'm an electrical engineer by profession, so I mustn't be nasty about them, but it's the ground conditions change and all sorts of other things change. But we could always, in those days, we could always say to our contractor, we don't want you to do this, we want you to do this instead, or we want you to do it in this particular way. And there was always discussion, interaction between the client and contractor, which seems to have been eliminated now. In fact, the first drawing office I worked in, we had, as draftsmen do, they produced a tongue-in-cheek guide for aspiring engineers. And the two things I remember from that was, one, the definition of the engineer. It said the engineer, as specified herein, or as referred to herein, shall be the engineer or anyone employed by him to make trouble for the contractor. Sadly, some engineers actually took this seriously, as contractors will tell you. And the other one was that the dealing with extras and variations, and it said that the use of the term extras by a contractor shall render him liable to prosecution under the Publication of Obscene Matter Act 1958. If we can solve those problems, if we can get back to decent specifications and contracts and where we can actually interact with the contractor, then we'll start to get somewhere. And I can understand why the water companies end up with this final conclusion, because of the problems involved. If they're making enough money, as they are, kitted out as they are, and with the techniques, why should they want to change? I can understand them wanting to stay as they are. These last two, I think, are quite relevant because the operatives feel that new technology threatens their job security. Anyway, we've come up with something which we hope will help. This last finds favour with a number of water companies now because they see the burden of trying to provide field trials and all the hassle involved will be reduced to really one field trial, which almost certainly will work. That's a worry. With all these fittings, when you've actually fitted them and buried them, will the gaskets relax and start to leak? This is basically the very simple idea. We've got a length of 600 millimeter diameter PE, and we've got holes in it, so we can slide into the bottom a length of corroded, old, dirty water pipe to really test the fittings under the limiting. We want to know how bad the corrosion and everything on the outside of the pipe can be and still be sealed by a fitting. And we also need to test pipe cleaning techniques. And that's the way we use it, and that provides weather protection and a safe working environment for the men. That's a fitting we've been looking at. It's a field-proven fitting. When installed by a man in a man-sized hole, it's a good fitting in that it we know it works, and it can be used to seal perforation leaks or encapsulate leaking flanges and leaking fittings even, leaking couplings. And we believe that it is susceptible to adaption, relatively easy, to apply this down a hole with down the hole tools. And the manufacturer is quite enthusiastic as well about this. He thinks that this can be done. So hopefully we're going to make some progress there. Just to explain why I've called it a hole in one, I'm told that all the big knobs who make the decisions spend Friday on a golf course. So I thought a golfing analogy they would understand. Currently par four, that's one, two, three and four. Now, core and back is a hole in one. We can now dig the holes, but in the 30 years that have gone since privatisation, we've forgotten all about the tools. So we need fittings and tools to actually use in the bottom of the holes, and not just the simple service connections. We want the whole range of things that we can do down holes. Now, as I said, pipe bursting, you have a whole line, maybe a 100-metre coil of pipes going in, you've got 10 holes. The hole for the pipe to go in and the hole for the rod puller, quite big. Tractor Technic have got a thing called a burst form, which flattens and then re-rounds pipe to allow it to be pushed or pulled around very tight radiuses to get it in a manhole, and I think it could be developed to work down a core hole. I'm sure they'd be interested in looking at that. And they also have a down-the-hole mini drill, which goes down mini-directional drill, which goes down a 600 millimeter core hole. In the bottom of that, at the heart of that, is a very neat little rod puller. And if we didn't have all the directional drilling kit down there and whatever, then I'm sure they could develop that to pull a lot harder and do the job. So there are things there to think about. And I think we do need to change a lot of attitudes if you want to move forward with new technology and take advantage. And I say, we're talking about millions of pounds potential savings here just with your attack on small holes. Now, I'm not going to I'm quite happy with the musical ability of the status quo in dire straits, but it is a fact that if you're making things and you stop doing research and development to save costs, your life becomes very limited. But you must concentrate on research for what you need. Sometimes the solutions are there doing something else. I mean, NASA spent a lot of money developing a pen that would write in space, and the Russians just used pencils. A lot of excuses. Congestion is an excuse. Well, you can't use core and down the hole technology with all these other things, in the old pipes and cables in the way. That's just the reason you want to look at this. You can insinuate a clever piece of kit and a tool down through between cables and whatever a lot easier than you can insinuate a man. And you know, unless you're in Wales, men don't like to be dropped down through cables held by their feet. We need to share everything. And this is always what puzzled me. If somebody permanently parked, blocked your driveway, would you just live with that? Would you go and leave your car outside or something? And yet we allow them to people to come and lay pipes and cables and fiber optics and everything on top of our water mains. And I remember going back again, probably 40 years now, when contractors brought a big gas main across our farm, and they had to go across the road, and there were big trunk telephone cables up either side. And I was talking to them and said, what about this road crossing? Oh, there's no problem, we get a road crossing. What about the cables? And they said, oh, we don't have a problem with that. The machine will go straight through then, won't notice them. And they did. And BT then had to come out and repair them. We've got, with core and vac, we can go through anything. We can go through rebar. If they won't move the stuff out of the way, we'll cut it out of the way for them. Now, I know that's a bit radical, but we really ought to be fighting our corner and saying, look, if you put your stuff in our way, that's your problem, not ours. British Gas came to us when I was with Welsh Water and said, you can't pipe burst within 3 feet of our pipes. So we said, well, tell us where the pipes are. And as you know very well, they couldn't. And finally, right back to square one, the footpaths are very congested, but if we got all that stuff out of the way and laid a multi-utility trough and put our stuff back in, it's not going to get any easier. The more we forget about it and let it go on, let the chaos build and the congestion increase, the worse it's going to get. So we must think about things in a much more sensible way. And it can be done by all sorts of people. Even the cat can think outside the box. Finally, I'd like to thank our sponsors in the Pipeline Innovation Research Club, who have agreed to fund the development of this facility, which we can hope will lead to increased development, accelerated development of tools and fittings for the water industry. Thank you very much.
Is also looking at vacuum excavation, looking at an overview of the systems, and particularly with some new systems that RSP have been developing. And this is going to be given by Lloyd Gardner, who's the director with RSP UK. Lloyd?
Okay, good morning, everybody. My name's Lloyd Gardner. I'm from RSP UK. I'm one of the directors there. I'd like to explain to you some of the projects we've been working on over the last couple of years since the NODIG live last show. I'd like to start by thanking you all for coming this morning. I think we must have a few sore heads from the UK STT awards dinner last night, but thank you for attending. I'd like to start just with a small video, a presentation to introduce the company.
looking for a machine to perform our special services, particularly on difficult-to-access construction areas or places with cables in the ground. A conventional excavator was not an option.
These units are customized units. They have specific applications. From three engine turbines to separate water tanks, all components are planned individually. So whatever the customer wants is what we can deliver. Our internationally patented dry suction principle guarantees the highest degree of gravity separation, lowest load on the filters, and thus consistently high suction performance. All types of media can be sucked, solid materials even up to 10 inches.
The use of dry suction excavation greatly improves our site safety. Whenever we work on critical services with this new vehicle platform, we eliminate potential damage.
Okay, RSP, we're very proud to announce on the 1st of July this year that RSP UK was launched. As you can see, our service partners are growing around the world now. On the 1st of July, RSP UK was launched. This is just a quick overview of our management team, and we're very pleased to be able to take on a full host of different people now of different experiences, who are fully trained around sales, service and training. All our service engineers are fully trained at our manufacturing facilities in Germany, which is the old eastern part of Germany, a place called Saalfeld. And they're basically working together now with all our customers and supporting over 100 machines now in the UK. On stock, we hold approximately £250,000 worth of spare parts to support our customers throughout the year. What I'm here today to talk about is our latest invention, the new RD8000 suction excavator. We have many years of experience now since we first developed the ESE series of suction excavator. And I'd like to explain to you today the features and benefits around a new machine when we compare it against the conventional suction excavator that we all know. So as we can see here, the one on the left, a conventional machine, and then the new design on the right-hand side. So some of the main points we want to touch on, is, like I say, all the features around the machine. The first one being, what have we changed, what have we done? One of the main points is the symmetrical superstructure of the machine, how the tank now is symmetrical in the centre of the machine, and how the power arm or the articulated hose carrier is positioned in the rear of the vehicle as well. This gives us the flexibility for storage on both sides of the vehicle, so we have twice as much storage as we did before, and we've also got additional storage space now for extension hoses and accessories that was unknown on the previous machines. The cooling system on the latest machine is all incorporated now between the cab and the superstructure. This is a tried and tested feature, and it works very, very well. And we've also optimised the whole design of the new vehicle now. We've saved over 800 kilograms in weight on the new DV fan. And by using innovative materials, we've saved a further 200 kilos. So in total, for the customer, we've increased the vehicle's payload by 1 ton. The airflow through the machine has been greatly improved and taken one step further. We've been working very closely with some technical universities, including FEM multi-phase flow stimulation. And basically, this is a much preferred method now and has a drastic improvement on fuel consumption as well. With this, the filter cartridges have also been modified, upgraded, with the support cages being removed, which minimises the losses of airflow, increasing the suction performance for a longer period of time, and this also reduces maintenance and servicing costs. Okay, the main point we'd like to talk about, obviously, the new machine. One of the biggest features of the new machine, where the conventional machines were limited to only tipping on one side of the vehicle, is the new machine can tip in both directions. This gives us the flexibility tip near side or off side, but we can also increase the tip and height of the container. This allows us to tip into grab lorries or tipper chassis. And it also enables us to control the tilt angle of the container, and it's possible to control the lid also whilst tipping to limit and control the material as it's coming out from the container. The four stabilizers on the vehicle now are fully automatic. On the original machines, there was obviously only two on the near side. With the European trucks, and on the offside for the UK trucks. The central levelling system now is fully automatic. So that takes away from the operator any control that's required individually, depending on the surface. It's automatic, like the push of a button, it'll find its place and level before you're allowed to tip the container. So we can see here, this is the new design. We're tipping to the near side or off side, and this is our tipping height here, which we can vary between 1.9 and 2.5 meters. You can see here the split lid design. So we can obviously tip here, near side and off to the off side, and it's controlled by a hydraulic cylinder in the middle. The tilt and axis is also controlled here, so you can vary the tilt angle as well whilst tipping. The power arm, as we all know, or the articulated hose carrier, is completely been redeveloped. It's given us a complete new concept from where we were before. We have a much working, a larger working area now, for approximately 20% when compared against the original power arm. And the main feature around this is the smart control system. The smart control system allows us to take the power arm from the transport position into the work position at the press of a button, and it also allows us to do the same when we store the power arm. So it takes away any operator error or damages that can occur through operator misuse or by accidental operation of the particular function. The smart control system, the main area as well where it's a much superior advantage to the original power arm is that we can control the last boom section now. So where before in the history on the conventional machines that you had to operate various functions on the joystick to maintain a vertical position on the suction nozzle, when you move the nozzle now, it's basically, we use software and sensors on the boom, so we can move the suction nozzle itself to stay at the same height as the ground by just moving one joystick. In the past, you had to move one, two, three, or four hydraulic cylinders, which is very time consuming. And obviously there's an issue there that if the operator hasn't been trained correctly, or there's an option of accidents that could potentially happen with that particular method. With the new smart control system as well, we're constantly monitoring the position of the hose. So where we looked at on the previous power arm, we're always looking into the hole at the suction nozzle itself, but we could have the hose, for example, at 90 degrees, which increases the wear and tear on the hose. So the life of the hose is increased now because we're constantly adjusting the arm of the arcle on the power arm itself to give us a smooth radius into the container. This here is just a drawing showing the differences compared to the traditional or conventional power arm. Okay, the new onboard electronic information system, the display, has always been in the fan housing in the past. This has now been moved to the rear of the vehicle, so the operator can monitor this easily. It's also positioned in the cabin as well. So there's two areas where the operator can look at this, and this records, monitors, and controls all the key data and parameters on the vehicle. We've now also included an RSP telematics feature, which allows you to receive information on the current status of the machine, any error codes or messages, and that's via the internet or an app. Obviously, there's significant advantages with improvements that include efficient job planning, GPS tracking, and reduced fuel consumption. Ladies and gentlemen, we are here all day today. The machine is actually with us. We'll welcome you to come over onto the stand. We're on stand 39 to have a look around the machine and explain in much more detail the improvements and features around the product. So thank you very much for your time today. If you do have any questions, by all means, please come and see us afterwards.
The last presentation is Frank Welter, and he's going to talk about an international view of markets for vacuum excavations, with particular reference to innovations for using them with the rail industry. So could you welcome Frank from MTS in Germany? Thank you.
Good afternoon, or good morning. Welcome you to our presentation for some ideas, some development which we found out in the market in the past. We are beside RSP, we are one of the bigger manufacturers for suction excavation systems, and since nearly 20 years on the market. And just give you an introduction, short agenda, who we are. Then I would like to get you some slides about an application benchmarking outside of the UK, what other companies and countries will do, especially Netherlands, Belgium, Scandinavia, Italy, and we have seen already some nice trucks running North America. And also at the last point, I would like to put a little bit of emphasis on rail industry, actual view for suction system, what's going on here, where is the development, how we see that, and okay, let's start from that side. What you see is an overview of our facilities. We are based in the southwest of Germany. From that point, we are serving, this is the main headquarter over there. Since many years, we are running our own company in France. Since 2 years now, we have our own subsidiary together with Mammoth here in the UK and focus in England on sales, support, service and everything that you need to run a fleet of such excavators. Our customers mostly are utility companies or service companies providing the service with operator or non-operated hire. What you see here is just a new thing what we invented in 2009. It's the so-called aggressive head or turning suction tube. At first I was very scared about that because I said, hey look, we are going to cut cables, lines, whatever. But at the end we found out that that we use, especially in on the continent, they use it to lose material layer by layer, work down, so they do not use it as a drill. And seems to be, due to the feedback of our customers, a very, very nice innovation that was made in the past. Power boom arms, yeah, for sure, we replace with our system, like the system do, the possibility to for strikes, which is the overall premise in the overall target. There are some special features. We can drive the truck forward, backward, steer it at the same time like a matchbox car, you know, helps us to, or helps the customer to make the work much, much more effective when they're going for trenches or cleaning up surfaces. So there was a huge development, innovation in the last 5 to 10 years driven by the manufacturers of vacuum excavation systems. Nevertheless, the awareness, and there are still some white spaces all over the world, especially also on the continent and here, where suction excavation is not known, or maybe there have been some bad experience made. Just a short overview over that. Now, the product range has grown up in the past over the years. So from a very small trucks like the Dyno City, which is just 2 or 3 years on the market, powerful tool, especially for congested areas, for going into the city area. We were looking for a truck which is powerful in suction, which makes some fun when you work with it. And the idea was at that time to transfer a lot of components which you find in the original bed and brother machines, the Dyno types, to put it in to get a reliable machine, and still getting more and more interest on that. On the other side, the bread and butter machines now using a two fan system, twin fan system to three fan system. We built quadruple fans also. Just these are mostly used for long distance suctioning, which is coming up more and more beside the utility work. Lloyd Gardner has pointed out the technology is in the meanwhile very, very international. I think the technology itself is nearly 30 years old, and our trucks, for example, they're working in more than 36 countries with an emphasis on Europe right now. Looking in some markets where we find suction excavator, newest markets for us is North America. The colleagues are a little bit longer there already. Here's a picture in Toronto, and my colleague Frank Gaudi said, it's like you're bringing coals to Newcastle. Hydro excavation is very big over there since many years, a long tradition. And now we're coming in with dry suction. Dry suction seems to be the word what we have to keep in mind. This is how they're gonna talk about our fan systems and not using water. We may use water, but it's not mandatory for that. We see actually they are using that in a utility area, in utility work, like everything starts mostly in, just except one country, coming to that later on, most of the work starts in utility work, and they are looking for new applications, what they can do, and found out that also, yeah, there's a big advantage if they use dry suction. As I said, traditionally hydro excavation, yeah, for sure, having a truck like that, you have to sell it in any form, you know, you have to convince the customer what is the argumentation, why they should use dry suction. And one thing was for sure, the material which you suck up is dry, so you can easily get rid of it. Maybe you can reinstall it, bring it back into the holes. But on the other side, we have significant advantages, getting smaller hoses, it's cleaner afterwards, and just got a case study on that, 3 to 4 times faster than the hydro excavation. For sure, we are facing a problem with our suction excavation systems due to we are using a fan system, means high speed of air producing at a cold temperature, yeah, frozen stuff, so the material will froze directly on the tubes, on the pipe going in, and this is what they have over there in really Northern America, and this is why we equip sometimes trucks going over there with a system with hot water like the hydro excavator do, especially to use it in low temperatures. Scandinavia started 5 years ago. Some pregnancies take longer, you know, so we have had a contact since 10 years with Scandinavian customers, and for sure they also have a problem with deep temperatures, but they're very multifunctional in using their trucks over there, so it could be utilities, it could be cleaning up tanks. They did big projects, for example, for the oil platforms when they get recycled. They have pylons inside where they have earths inside, and they have to get rid of the earths before they can get rid of the pylons over there. Big projects over there. And suctioning of snow, also possible. They just take off the filters, so nothing will happen then. And working in buildings, cleaning up everything what we find here, but sometimes the environmental situation is worse than with us here, temperature wise. The market is interesting over there. Mostly they take trucks which are fully equipped, full optional, you know, hydrostatic drive, very high suction performance inside, big trucks, and very nice looking trucks. So it seems to be money is not the big problem over there. There are some more applications, but you see the surrounding over there, also cleaning up tunnels, you know, is coming up right now. After floods, so pretty nearly the same, but more focused on non-utility. What a little bit excourse on suctioning, not especially suction excavator, is the long tradition that they bring waste bins underground. For example, Göteborg has summer houses in real statements which are completely where you put off a door, put your bin in or put your sack of trash in, and it's sucked into the cellar room and stays there, and then one of these refuse suction units is coming and take it off, so they get rid of the ears. In some areas they would like to get rid of the bin wagons coming and collecting it. And also what we see, for example, in Denmark, that they have underground containers in residential areas where they just put their sacks in, and then also this refuse suction unit is coming and take it off, so nothing will be again in the environment, so it's closed, and then they bring it to a disposal area. So this is a system what we developed 5-6 years ago already. We just transferred the technology of suctioning from the suction excavator into this refuse suction unit, and the Scandinavian are very innovative at that, and this is the major market for these waste suction units. But that's just a small excourse what they're going to do there. Yeah, Italy is a special market with a long history on suctioning. They do everything, but mostly not in the utility area. So what we found out with our customers, they working in buildings. They are getting, for example, here that was a good. We do not have that here. They got in, get off the pigeon shit. Sorry for that word. So they suck it up under circumstances with protection, air protection, and going up into buildings and renovate them. But we see also applications like suctioning up bentonite. Everybody who is involved in that knows that this is not an easy job due to bentonite is depending on the viscosity. It's not easy to suck, but that could be easily done with our suction excavators. Let's see. Yeah. Okay. Maybe coming to Netherlands and Belgium. This country started nearly 15 years ago, has just a 15-year history on suction excavation. Actually, we would estimate there's around about, in general, 150 suction excavators there. They are facing mostly, especially in Netherlands, sand and clay material over there. And they developed, and beside utility pipe working, long distance suctioning, the industry work, which I would like to put a little bit emphasis on, because we found as a reference customers some interesting interesting customer list: Total, Exxon, Shell, BASF, Covestro, Sealand Refinery. So unfortunately there are no pictures available for the work over there because it's forbidden. They all seems to be very afraid of bomb attacks or whatever. But nevertheless, I would like to go deeper here inside in that one, because this is a special part of suctioning. So the increase of safety built on the truck is very important. They have an association which is called SIR, S-I-R. This is a association between WAC manufacturers and the customers, so means the refineries. And they defined some years ago a minimum standard what a WAC truck should have. And this is what we have seen in the past. All trucks, for example, going to Netherlands, they have a so-called industry package. This industry package is optional. For example, they are looking for several emergency stops, more than you have already under the CE certification on it. And very interesting, they are all afraid of electrostatic load, so they would like to get rid of that. So not only a reel with a connection to the soil, is needed. No, it has to be measured. So there is special grounding device control, which shows an acoustic and visible signal if the truck is not longer grounded to the earth. Then what we're going to use is X-Zone 2 protection of radio controls. That means you're allowed only to use radio controls in certain zones. I do not speak about zones which are high explosive. I think we will never reach that. This is very, very special. But they get a certain approval for some of these Artex zones. We are using a non-static hose. That means even for the friction that creates electrostatic load, we get rid of that, so that we use a non-static suction hose. For sure, there will be a CE approval by a certified company. And what we found very nice to have is also a gas detection system. We are going to measure the gas percentage in the airflow and shut down the system if there is any explosive mixture available. ADR approval is possible. You know, ADR means this is the transport approval for contaminated material, but we see suction excavators not in that field that you can get flammable or explosive materials in. This is a kind for vacuum trucks which are certified on X or directly on Artex. We have an intermediate thing in, so they would never be able to suck diesel or benzene, whatever, you know, flammable material. But nevertheless, in these refineries, they have applications, they have a lot of glass fiber, they have a lot of pipes to uncover, and this is a thing what they should have, or what they recommend, what is mandatory to work in those industrial areas. Now, Spain is a special market, so there are just a few things here. There's a Spanish suction excavator working on doing trenches in combination with a grinder for laying gas lines. So this is coming up. We see a lot of suction excavators working in the cement industry, replacing typical vacuum trucks because they're much, much quicker there. And yeah. Due to the economical situation in the past, it has to be a very flat market. Now, there was a picture I missed, yeah, from Italy, just stepping back. Hydro demolition was always a big thing, so cutting concrete with high pressurized water and then get rid of the material. Here we see it on a bridge, or maybe if you're driving down from Austria to Italy over the Brenner, you will find a lot of work has to be done with hydro demolition. And what they're going to do, they take the suction excavator together with high pressurized water to clean the surface in between the steel pipes that new concrete can be put on. Yeah, a little bit more construction in Italy, long distance driving. Always the problem is you have to get the material. This is in a house where it was not accessible with any else. So they take the mini excavator and feed the suction nozzle. Yeah, coming now to the last part of my presentation, just would like to show you what is actual the situation in use of suction system rail. We have seen it already here from the presentation, so this is a big issue, and it's really nice to suck gravel due to the stones are made for suctioning, you know, and those who have ever worked with a fork, you know, in there and to get rid of the ballast know that this is the hell of the work. So suctioning is quite very, very nice and smart thing to get rid of the ballast. There are some systems on the market. What we see here is a so-called suction box, what we're gonna have sometimes in combination with railroad digger, and this suction box is a smaller suction system which is driven by the power pack of the excavator. And it takes one cubic meter, it has a hydraulically driven fan, it has filter system inside, and it opens either to the bottom or can be tipped to the side. So these are for smaller things, always in combination with a railroad excavator, which should have at least 16 ton. Some years ago, we had the request for a system in Belgium to work on the rails. They have been looking to make foundations left and right side to the tracks, and the thing was at the end, how can you get rid of the sucked material? So this is mostly the big problem, where can you make a disposal of the sucked material? And we came up with a solution on a system which is on tracks. Just a dyno type twin fan system, powerful, able to swivel the arm from the left to the right side, like the JCBs we can find when they swivel their arms, their digger arms. And the logistic concept was falling behind. So it starts to suck here, suctioning. It tips, there you see the different material over there. And if it tips, it just moves a little bit forward. And it starts again with this process. Suctioning, tipping, move forward. Suctioning, tipping, move forward. And that was the clue behind of that. And actually, it's used at again doing foundations in the Scandinavian region. What we've seen today in the presentation, for sure, also and from other contractors, is another thing. We have trucks. We have trucks, suction trucks, which are going over long distance. They are staying outside the tracks, get an extension tube to the tracks, and over there, people or some drones or some mooners, however you call them, are working to collect the material. Sometimes good, sometimes the excess is not there, so means if the tracks is 20 kilometers away in an area where you cannot access, then you have to have something else. And what is now in England are some types of these railroad vehicles. These are suction excavators, which include a system that you can run it on the rail, or get out of the rail and drive it on their normal wheels over there. This system is a special system. It's electrical-wise adapted to the needs. There was a big change in the European norm right now, so they increased the demand on what they all need, what have to be tested. And also you see, this is a total other shape. The shape is in relation to the tunnel profile, that it can go through, there is enough space that it will not stick in. Here we see one of the former ones on a rail, working to get rid of everything, gravel, cleaning activities or whatever. Actually, we're working on a project where we have seen a demand from this track unit. We call it the Dino rail tank, which is now can then later on equipped with a system where you can drive on the rails directly. So you would not need again a trailer and a locomotive who is going to tow or to push the system. So this is actually what is on the market from a railway side. There are some more concepts coming up, and Yeah, I thank you very much for your attention on that. We'll be there for questions.
Very much, Charles. An interesting introduction to the session, outlining what the real problem is, outlining some of the things that we might be looking to develop in the future. Now, the next speakers are going to be talking about their particular systems for vacuum excavation, some of which have been innovative. And first of all, we're going to hear from Lewis Rust, who is general manager with SES. And he's going to talk about vacuum excavation solutions and outline some of the case studies of where their solutions have been used. So, Lewis.
Thank you.
Sorry, am I?
Morning, everybody. My name is Lewis Rust. I'm the general manager for Suction Excavation Solutions, or as we call it, SES for brief. I'm here this morning to talk to you what we do, how we do it, and give you some case studies as well in regards to some specific sectors that we work in, how we support those sectors, look into a bit more detail on actually what we do. Also going to give you a bit of an overview in what we do in our training department as well. So I might have some information for you guys to take away today. Training is going to be a big part of what we're doing going forward. So to give you a bit of an overview, if you like, into the team, the cold face, if you like, or the operatives, we've got 8 operatives using 5 machines. They're EUSR, PTS, asbestos awareness, and confined space trained. At SES, our number one priority is safety, and we like to invest in our people, and that's really important for us so our customers can feel confident in the fact that they're going to do a safe job when they're on site. So these are the applications that at the moment we're involved in. This is growing every day. We're working with our customers and they're using different ways in which they can use the machinery for different applications, getting involved in more specialist jobs. But at the moment, you know, supporting the building sector, the water, the rail, chemical plants, that kind of stuff, and utilities is our main bag, if you like. So let's look into it in a little bit more detail. So the water industry. So we split it into 2 sections. So the clean water, in terms of stuff that we drink. We are part of the network lead pipe replacement program, water meter replacement, and the installation program as well. Network upgrades, leakages, and emergency repair works. On the wastewater and recycled water side, cleaning of holding tanks, material removal of the filter beds, removal of sludge and silt, and again, supporting them with the reactive emergency works. So we're going to go into a case study now. I'm going to give you like a before, a mid, and an after. So this is a reservoir cleanup program where we were called out to site, had a buildup of sand that the business needed to remove. Now the previous methods that they were using to remove, you can see that there, were the conveyor belt systems feeding it up the bank here. 30 metres up to the bank with manual intervention at the bottom and at the top to load the sand onto the conveyor and back off again. It usually took them about 3 days. So they approached us and said, how can you help us? We need to think of a safe solution, speed up the method and make sure that we can kind of think about how we're going to do this going forward as well, so it's a long-term solution. So this is during the job. So we've used a 32-ton, 10 cubic metre capacity machine. We're excavating roughly around 1 load per hour, including tipping. What we've done here, you can see, we've fixed the piping to the bank using straps and strops to make sure we don't get the movement with the piping, make sure it's as safe as it could be. hence the speed of the removal of the material. So here you can see the finished article. We actually excavated 8 loads in the day, 80 cubic metres. One day to do it instead of 3. And the reduction of manual intensive labour, so happy customer. So I'm going to go into a bit more detail about the rail industry. So we all get frustrated when we happen to stand by the railway line waiting for our train to arrive, or doesn't arrive at all. But actually for the rail industry, it's astronomical costs that are attached to that. So we're working closely with the rail industry to support them with basically the sleeper rejuvenation program, tunnel clearing, the wet beds drainage systems, and removing contaminated ballast as well. And this is, again, they're finding more and more ways in which they can use our machinery to support them in their business. So job request here, 8 metres to the top of the tunnel here. Day one, we were lucky enough where the train line wasn't live. We were able to come at it from a slightly different angle. But there's 2 phases to this job that we'll go into. Essentially, there's loose debris that was falling onto the track here, potentially causing injury, stoppages, delays, which again is huge, huge cost. So we look at the first phase. We decided to come from the bottom of the tunnel using a 26-ton 8-cube tank. We fed the piping up the bank 21 metres from the back of the truck to the point of excavation. On this phase, we removed 4 loads of material successfully in the first day. You see on the left side now here, this is phase 2. We've come from the top of the bank, the reason being that it's a live train line on this day, at this phase. And here we've, it's 30 metres of tubing or piping to the point of excavation using the 26-ton truck. We excavated 6 loads on that day, making sure that here, with the finished article being clear of debris, making it a far safer environment. And the customer's extremely happy based on the fact that we've reduced the time frame. This could take them up to 2 weeks to do this type of job. Here it's taken us 2 days, and again, in the long term, limit the risk and save cost. So moving on to our training side of things, EUSR Gold Training Standard Centre that we've invested lots of money into to make sure that when people are in the learning environment, that they can get as much out of it as possible. RSP Training Centre of Excellence for UK and Ireland. And the money we've invested has allowed us to look at the way in which people learn. We've got a modern, spacious kind of training facility with touchscreen interactive learning, even stage utilities areas for suction demos. And the feedback we've had so far from the candidates that have been on the training course has been very positive. So that's quite a big thing that we're looking at now for the rest of this year and next year. Finally, I'd like to thank you for your time. Thank you to No Dig Live for allowing us to do the presentation. Thank you.
So if there's any questions from the audience, please raise your hands.
It's very bright.
Hi, Tim Hall from Total Flow. We're working with on a project looking at laying of pipes using some horizontal drilling and then breaking into the pipes using small core excavations. So very interested in Charles' initial applications. Just in terms of giving us some calibration about the cost to run per hour of the kind of vacuum excavation machines, I can imagine quite a lot of power is used. Are you talking in terms of number of litres per second of fuel consumed? What are the running costs plus the manning costs of these kind of units when you're actually in the field?
The simple answer to your question is no, I can't. The actual fuel consumption of a typical, there's so many different little machines, and I'm looking at the smaller machines, but they're certainly comparable to a mini excavator, for instance. The fuel consumption really is relatively small. The effort required to drill the core is relatively small. Running costs are very small. You'd hopefully be looking at replacing the service layer or the main layer's vehicle with the machine, the actual vehicle, which will carry all the bits and pieces as well as the core and the vacuum tank. So you've only got the one vehicle, so your fuel costs are going to be considerably less than doing it the conventional way, very considerably less, because you've actually got some quite big vehicles bringing stuff on site and off site again. But no, I can't give you individual consumption figures, but I can tell you they are very low. The cost of the vehicle, I mean, you're talking about, I suppose, what, $250,000, $250,000, probably, well, certainly $200,000 for a vehicle like that. We have, one of the things that concerned most people was how long the drill bit, the core, would last, because that's quite an expensive piece of kit. And typically we were finding we could drill about 40 cores before we needed to refurbish the, and then we simply needed to refurbish it, put new tips on.
Not sure if I understood very good your question due to my German base. Just spoke yesterday with one of our customers. We have a coring rig in combination with a suction rig on our stand, and I asked the gentleman, where do you see the advantage in it? He said, Frank, very clear, but we have to certify it. We're working since some time with them. We're going to expect a price reduction. He said, okay, what have we done before? We opened a pit 150, 150 to 90 deep, and we calculated around about £500 for that. And we see a tremendous decrease in costs coming down a factor five to eight, he said. I said, okay, cannot believe that, but okay, you know it better than me. So there seems to be a tremendous saving using coring together with vacuum excavation.
I think on average with fuel consumption, certainly on the larger machines, if we look at the standard double fan machines, I think on average you'll be around 25 to 30 litres of fuel per hour, to give you a rough guide. Obviously that can vary so much on the specification of the chassis and the superstructure itself. For the larger machines where we go up to 3-stage fans or 4-stage fans, then the fuel consumption can go up to 40, 50, 60, 70 litres or more an hour. So it's very important, I think, to spec the right tool for the job, so you're not using fuel unnecessarily. Yes, there are 3-stage, 4-stage fans available, but really those types of machines are only used for long distance work. So really if we're working at the back of the machine, we're only working 2 or 3 meters away, it's not necessary to have that much power, so therefore you don't need the additional cost of the machine, you don't need the additional noise from the machine, you don't need the additional fuel consumption, wear and tear. So it's very very important to suspect the vehicle around the type of work you're doing. But
there is the other thing, is that if you're digging it conventionally, you've also got an air compressor running to power your breaker to break up the road and dig it anyway, so that there are fuel costs there, and the difference really isn't very much, but considerably less if you've got to bring transport in and out.
Okay, thank you. Any more questions from the floor? I've got a question based on Charles mentioning the difficulties of using vacuum excavation to excavate in clay, and wonder if the other three speakers would like to say how they're overcoming that problem, if they do see it as a problem.
From my perspective of view, clay spades, this is just a tool, you know. We as a manufacturer, we try to provide certain options. At the end, the operator has to to choose what he wants, you know, what he likes to do, what is needed. But we have seen due to the use of this power boom arm that they can press inside a little bit or loosen it, and the turnable suction tube just to loosen the clay, even to use just normal air toolings, except the air spade, because this is definitely, it could be a dangerous thing, because you're cutting something, you're going in where you can't see anything. We have seen tremendous increase in efficiency in the due to these new things coming in, so power boom arm, turnable suction tube, better air spades, you know, on that. For sure, it's much more easy to dig in the sand in a ground which is already was disturbed than going in virgin clay ground. But our suction excavators and also those from the colleagues that work in worldwide in all of those areas, and also the idea is also, or the question is, what is the alternative?
Absolutely, and I think that it's the hardest material for all of us to work in. Clay is very, very difficult to work in. We know sometimes the air tooling doesn't touch the clay, it's not porous, so it's very difficult to excavate. Yes, we do have the option of high pressure water that we can cut the soil, but then we have all the other issues around using water on site, which is obviously very, very messy. You've got the potential hazards of firing high pressure water around potentially damaged cables that nobody knows. We've then got to look at the costs of removing that water from site, the environmental charges to get rid of that. The other thing is obviously the downtime. If you have to leave the site with the slurry or the mixture of water that you've created, obviously the customer has downtime. So yes, it's a solution that you can cut clay, but it brings many other negative points along with it. So yes, it's something we're working towards at the moment to try and find additional tools that we can use in the future, but I think we all have similar kind of experiences at the moment, and it's certainly something that's ongoing and we're still looking into.
Could I just add that there is this perception that if you use water, you end up with slurry, and that defeats the whole object of what I've been looking at, is that I want to be able to put back the stuff I've just got out of the hole, because I'm doing this, it's only taking me maybe 2 or 3 hours to do core and back hole and repair it and get it back and move on to the next one. If I can't take this, if I can't do anything with the slurry, then it defeats the whole object. What we have found is that you conventionally use a water lance. I mean, we used to use an air lance, and that's fine, but it's not in cohesive material. And it also tends to spray showers of stones and things all over the road. Health and safety, you have to wear earmuffs then so you can't hear the sound of the stones rattling off the passing vehicles and the screams of the passers-by. But basically, if you use a water lance then, which will cut clay, once you start to use the lance, the hole starts to fill with water. So what do you do? Do you stop immediately and let the vacuum suck the stuff out, or do you keep going to make sure you've got plenty of stuff cut up for it to lift out? So you do have a slurry. With the cutting jetting system built into the head that I've described, that I saw working in Australia, let's say many, many years ago, very effectively, you do not get slurry. And what we need to do as a water industry is say to the vacuum excavator manufacturers, this is what I actually want. I want to be able to dig clay. I want to be able to dig it wet, dry, if you see what I mean. I want use water by all means, but I don't want it to result in a slurry. That is the task we need to set them. And that's why I say if we ban clay spades, we'll drive the industry in the right direction. They will know if they solve the problem, they've got the commercial payback, because people will use the excavators. So that is the way forward. But you do not need a slurry. It's only that the way we use the water knife at the moment, it does produce a slurry, and people think that's what we've got to live with. But I think the gentlemen with me here know that we can do better than that, and I'm sure they're all looking at it. I mean, we did, as you say, we started a long time ago. We could drive down the road, 30 years ago with a Welsh water machine that swept the road, the half the road surface. In fact, we had to constrain it because we were knocking cyclists off as they cycled past, as the boom went backwards and forwards. But it did work after a fashion. Clay was the problem again, but when you start to look into the ground in front of a coring machine, you have a problem because the radar has got a very limited view. You're developing radar to look, to build into the head of a directional drill. So you look ahead of the pilot drill, you've got a very small hole you're drilling. The cone is only a few degrees wide, so you can only see a very limited area in front of you. It's a very nasty environment to try and put a camera on the front of a directional drill. When you're doing a core, you're talking about 600 millimeter diameter, you've got to look at a lot of ground. And if I was worried about there being something there, and I mean, hopefully there is, because I'm looking for a water main, but the records aren't always that accurate, but I'd learn all I wanted to from the surface before I started coring. I think it's a very good idea, if we're worried about surfaces, to run your radar over the ground where you're going to drill the core. But bear in mind, the core is only removing the hard material. And surely there isn't going to be much laid in the top 12 inches or so. I mean, that core I showed you on the on the presentation, that was a very nasty area of Birmingham where we'd got a lot of tarmac and then sort of 12, sometimes 18 inches of concrete, and sometimes with rebar in it. But once you're through that, you can feel that. Anyone who's drilled a hole through the wall, you can feel when the drill goes through. As soon as it's through, and the colour of the water coming round changes, you can see that you've gone through the hard stuff. You stop coring at that point, and thereafter you go down with the vacuum excavator, hopefully without the use of a clay spade, and you don't damage anything. I would use radar to look into the ground anyway. I think that's a very good idea, before you dig the hole even, because in the old days, we used to have to hand dig whenever we got near electricity cables. Don't use the machine, use hand dig. Well, I know I would rather be sitting in the JCB, driving it, holding a couple of joysticks, than on the end of a pickaxe going through a cable. So find out before. Use the radar first, and then core. Engineering approach, stand well back and take pictures.
Yeah, I totally agree. But I was really trying to use the development of GPR as an example of how things have progressed.
Yes.
And I was wondering how you see the progression now with this research development, how you see the development of these down the hole tools, which can be used in connection with coring.
Well, hopefully. There's a whole range of fittings and tools and things that can be developed. Hopefully manufacturers who will want to develop these things will be able to use this facility without having to bother the water industry to set up trials. They can come to this site and in complete you couldn't put this kit down the hole to mend a leak with all that water spraying in the air. So, well, you don't actually work like that. You don't put your main layers in the hole with water spraying all over the place. You slow the flow down using a thing called a valve, which they didn't seem to have grasped. So, you know, it can be done, but the fittings are one side. We need to work then with the water companies themselves, their contractors, their main laying gangs, preferably the old timers who know actually how to do it. And they will then perfect the wet hole technique for us, bring the two together. I don't know a main layer who wouldn't rather do it from the surface in the dry than down the hole up to his middle in water.
Well, let's hope the facility does encourage a few developments in the industry and we get less digging in the road, which we're going to get with vacuum excavation. But coupled with new tools for working down the hole, this should help considerably. Has anybody got a last question before we close the session? In which case, we will close the session, and I'd like you just to give the usual round of appreciation to the speakers. Thank you. Thank you.